am I audible?
Yeah. So we certainly have a very great and very balanced panel representation here on the dais. I must say we have representation from one of the leading IPP player, also from the EPC and the channel partners, and also from the DISCOMs, and also from the OEM. So and lastly from the rating agency. So we have a very balanced and diverse representation here to discuss the variety of the issues, both for the utility and the rooftop space. Let me take first question to Mr. Sumit here, who represents the IPP and Sprung Energy. I would like you know, to understand from you and share your perspective on the kind of execution challenges that you are facing currently with respect to the land and the transmission connectivity approvals. In fact, for most of the projects which are coming up in Gujarat for the wind and solar, they have faced a tremendous problem in terms of getting the land availability. And there was apparently a change in the land policy document by the state government of Gujarat sometime in Jan 2019. And that created a lot of issues for projects under the pipeline. So, so how do you see the current status in terms of the land availability for the projects under the pipeline? That's one. And number two, how do you see the connectivity approval status? Because that is something which is not even within the control of an IPP, right? So what kind of coordination is required? What's your experience so far? And how an IPP can mitigate this risk, you know, while participating in the upcoming bids. I mean, these are very two important, you know, variables for a utility scale project to start with. Yeah, please.
Basically, you touched upon the most sensitive part of the business as an IPP. These are the most important parameters because of which the projects are getting delayed. First, to answer with about land. So you are correctly pointed out there was change in land policy. So basically, this was not done in Gujarat itself. It was done in Tamil Nadu as well. So overall, it affected the solar projects as well as wind projects. We have wind projects both in Tamil Nadu and in Gujarat. So our 197.5 megawatt, which I showed, was actually delayed, and it is sitting in the phases wherein LDs are encashed. But we are still hopeful, and we are approaching the authorities stating the same reasons that because of this, the LDs shouldn't be encashed. And we are hopeful that authorities might understand the topic. Same thing we did for SECI projects, and everyone did it. MNRE has understood these facts, SECI has understood these facts. And on real grounds, they are giving the extension to the projects. So basically in Tamil Nadu, we got the extension for SCOD. Similar way in Bhadla, if you see, there are IPPs who have faced even issues in solar park. In Rewa also, we face the same issue. Basically the understanding is if it is a solar park, there is no land and grid evacuation issue, but that's not the fact. Government itself faces the problem while building the solar park as well. In fact, in Gujarat also, Radhanesda and Dholera solar parks are there. In fact, Charanka also. In Charanka also, GP government authorities were also had issues while delivering the land on time. The only thing is one solar park is there. If delay in land is there, okay, the project LDs are not levied. But it overall impacts our module procurement. Module prices are fluctuating, everyone knows that. Then we fall in the SGD site. SGD was also there. So now, going down the line, what has happened that government knows these facts. We represent MNRE, we make them understand, okay, these are the issues. So these are covered, first of all, covered under PPA. For example, SGD bidding in case of solar, it was already covered that SGD would be considered as change in law. Otherwise, there were cases prior to that, IPPs faced wherein change in law, GST implication was not considered in change in law by respective commissions or the authorities which had signed the PPL. But now it is considered. So this mitigates risk. Another side, I already told that regarding land, land also they understand, so okay, they give that leeway. Third thing about grid connectivity. Now most of the projects which are coming up, either in solar or wind, water it might be, they are trying to be connected to ISTS, basically interstate transmission system, so that the burden is not there on state DISCOMs as well as transmission systems, because they will have to charge the transmission charges. Overall, as waiver is there at the central level, so ISTS connected projects are there. But again, these are very limited substations available. Now CEA, Central Electricity Authority, which is basically the developing the basically topmost agency in the country, which plans this infrastructure evacuation across the country. Now this has also geared up in, if you visit the websites and see, there is phase-wise, phase 1, phase 2, 66.5 gigawatt across the RE potential states, including solar and wind. They have given and given a consideration that which are solar zones are there and where grid evacuation is to be done, what is the cost of it, how it should be done. So on regulatory side also, the changes were made. As you rightly pointed out, the grid connectivity was an issue. Grid connectivity at ISTS is traditionally built for thermal power plants. RE had different issues related to that. People used to sit on that connectivity for years together doing nothing. So new regulations were brought in wherein RE is to be considered, especially wind and solar. So new regulations help to stabilize that thing. Now if you have LOA or land, then only you get the connectivity. So it becomes first come, first serve basis. So it becomes very simple and easy. Accordingly, Power Grid was given, PGCIL was given the mandate, kindly issue where the evacuation availability is there. So now they are giving that also. They are publishing it. They are informing number of bays available at what substation, how much capacity can be injected. So developer is very much aware that which areas to be considered. Now if you say Badla, everyone knows Fatehgarh 2, basically near to Badla, it will take 2.5 years. So accordingly consider while bidding. So the risk itself gets mitigated.
Okay, thanks Sumit. Let me come to Mr. Munjal. We would like to hear your perspective on the business demand for you as an EPC player. In the context where we are seeing a slowdown in the macroeconomy, in a context where there could be possibility of deferment of capex by many of these corporate customers, we understand CNI is the most lucrative customer base, okay, because inherent economics for the CNI for the solar energy is quite viable and quite well understood. So do you see, you know, the impact on the demand from the CNI given the issues related to the slowdown in the economy and the risk of possible deferment of the capex, even though there are fundamentally no viability related issues?
Yeah, certainly we see that from compared to last year, that there has been some deferment in deploying the capital. But in general, you know, I divide the, so we have ground mounted EPC and we have rooftop. Ground mounted has been slow, but that's cyclical in terms of that depends on policy, how many projects are there. And we have seen that there are less number of players now. Developers are seeing that the quality and how the plant is constructed is more important than the cost. So we have seen more business in ground mounted, more inquiries. But rooftop in CNI segment, we have seen slowdown in probably, I would say, 10% at least. But the fundamentals of a company are really strong. So they are interested. They are, and I would divide them into two categories. One is centrally, you know, decision-making body, where is a large corporate and they want to make a decision on their plants. Another is local one or two unit companies. I see them, those small, I would not call it MSME, some of them fall under MSME. They have still gone ahead and made the decision to go with solar, but I still see in general about 10 to 15% slowdown in that.
Okay, thanks Munjal. But and also would like to hear your perspective on you know, the honorability of these contracts for a RESCO player. Are these do you see any issues related to honorability of these contracts? Because typically, you know, these contracts are either 3 year or 5 year, or at best 10 years. And we see that there are lock-in periods with termination viability, a termination penalty. But do you see any instances of honorability of such contracts for ESCO Plus?
Definitely. See, as years go by, there we'll see more. Personally, we have done about 40 to 50 megawatt of private PPA, and out of that, about 2 has collapsed, in a sense that the reason was, you know, suddenly we were doing 6 rupees PPA and now somebody's offering 3.9. So yeah, we see that. It's still not a bad ratio, and these are all AA, AAA rated companies. So I think inherently, two things. Inherently, when you decide to do RESCO, you take the risk of at least 5% not honoring, number one. Number two is, now if you talk to any RESCO, pretty much they were aggressive, but now they are not aggressive in terms of number of years, you know. So they want lock in of minimum 15 years. And they want life of PPA for 25 years. So that has been on the negotiation table now instead of a price, which everybody does realize that. Okay.
And lastly, we also want your perspective on the regulatory matters. You would be knowing there has been a policy flip-flop in Karnataka for third-party open access projects, and the matter is still pending at High Court divisional bench level. So in that context, how do you mitigate this risk through PPA mechanism? Is that possible? Or how do you see that as a regulatory challenge there?
It's a huge challenge. You know, suddenly we had a business plan of putting up 150 megawatts private PPA in Karnataka. Instead, we just ended up putting 35 megawatts. So it does affect, number one. But again, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, the challenge is always in India going to be tiptoe around policy. How do you make a business model viable? And that's always going to be a challenge for people like us. You know, we are a small to mid-sized company. And, you know, I'll give you a couple of examples. My couple of investors whose PPA got affected, still affected because of flip-flop. You know, then we had to go with the ingenuity of getting short-term PPAs, in a 6 months PPA, 1 year PPA. Not a good thing, but still there's something better than nothing. So, you know, we are getting them 6 months, 1 year PPA, 6 months, 1 year PPA. So we'll keep on doing that again. But I was going to invest 150 megawatt. Now I just stopped at 35 megawatt. So in India, what we have seen, that's always going to be your business model. Your everything will be around the policy. I'm not saying that's a good or bad, but that's the reality in India.
Thanks, Munjal. Let me come to Mr. KJ Shah. You highlighted, there is a possibility of consolidation in the market in your business segments, because there is a lot of fragmentation, there is a lot of huge level of competitive intensity in your business segment. So what's your views on that per se?
Yeah, consolidation is bound to happen, whether you see it in a telecom or in other industries. And as Munjal bhai says, like in ground mounted EPC segment, now the number of players developer chooses are shortlisting are less than before, because of the same reason that now when the full one circle of life cycle goes by, people start realizing about quality. When there is a new technology, new product, nobody knows about longevity or quality or anything else but the prices. So once that cycle gets completed, people start realizing about the quality, workmanship, engineering, and other backup service like that. And then the consolidation process starts. And the player who are serious, who are long-term players will be there, and all the short-term players will bound to vanish. So yes, consolidation is the key to this industry, because today there are too many players in every segment of this industry, and in order to build credentials and in order to get entry into certain markets, people are quoting absurd pricing and disrupting entire market.
Another very unique and important point is on the net metering regulations, which you highlighted. And apparently, these regulations vary quite widely across the states. What's the real ground, on the ground, your experience in terms of getting these net metering approvals, how much time it takes, how difficult it is, what kind of difficulties that you experience in getting these regulatory approvals for rooftop projects across the states? Maybe you can just share your perspective.
As far as Gujarat is concerned, we have a very good policy in place, and the coordination between different agencies like DISCOMs, nodal agency, and electrical inspectorate are quite good. Now in Gujarat, the entire process is being digitalized, and now on the portal created by JEDA, you can contact all stakeholders on a one platform. As far as other states are concerned, see, my views are, till the time DISCOM see the solar as their enemy, this is the animosity will always be there, and because of that, the inherent resistance by DISCOMs to smoothen the process will not be there. So first, government has to invest lot of money to sensitize DISCOMs that solar is the future, solar is part of their business and not the enemy, not cannibalizing their revenue. The business models are changing even for DISCOMs, and they have to realize these facts then and then. Because normally what happens, all the electricity regulatory, in all the electricity regulatory commissions, the biggest voice and strongest voice is of DISCOM, because they are well geared up to face electricity regulatory commissions, and they are well prepared compared to industry player, because today solar industry has no big player bearing few like Adani or Renew. So who can take head on to DISCOMs in matter of regulatory affairs? So DISCOM have their say in with regulatory authorities, and this is the reason, like UP, in UP, in Maharashtra, in Karnataka, the net metering flip-flops are there. Once they see that their revenues are being cannibalized, Maharashtra DISCOMs have taken up the matter with MERC and ultimately got what they want. So this is my view, that Central Electricity Authority or central government should step in and create a central policy for net metering, which all states have to follow. And if the DISCOM's revenues are being cannibalized, then they should be compensated in some way or other, because solar is bound to be here and it is becoming a force to reckon with. This is my views.
Yeah, thank you. In fact, that's a very fundamental point. The regulatory issues related to the net metering regulations, quite inconsistent, not at all across the states. We have a DISCOM representation as well on the dais, and this let me talk to Mr. Shah on this aspect. How do you see the coordination and the support and the willingness from the DISCOM, to allow such net metering approvals, particularly in Gujarat state? That's one. And number two, the renewable energy penetration is going up, right? So how do you see the impact of that on the DISCOM's finances going forward?
The net metering system is very well developed, and it has been already tied with the softwares and the digitalized, right? So there is a one benefit for the state of Gujarat that everybody can see, and it is working as of today very smoothly. So even though what are the problems are coming that Juvenile and all the distribution companies are trying to solve all these ones. The second question is very important. How the DISCOM will mitigate the challenge if the renewable generation is increased up to the 40% up to the 2030 or somewhere? Let me give one example. If there is a 40% generation from the RE in the system out of the total generation, if at 7 p.m. there is no solar and at the same time wind velocity is fallen down and wind generation is also at the least. So out of the total required generation or the total installation, 40% generation will be lost. At the same time, at 7 p.m., there is a 15 to 20% higher load. That is because of the peak hours. And because of that, the grid system cannot match the demand and supply, both. In that case, there may be a chances of disturbance creation in the grid. This is the most important worry or the most important challenge for the next coming years for the distribution company, because distribution company may have to purchase the costlier power from the gas or somewhere, or they have to impose load shedding. And now these are not the days, particularly for the Gujarat, to impose the load shedding. People cannot accept the load shedding now. So this is a big challenge, but this challenge can be resolved by using the battery storage system along with the grid. No doubt, as on today, the cost of the battery or this project may not be financially viable. But day by day, if we see the cost of the battery during last year, it has been fallen down 15 to 18%. So more and more use of the battery, if we go for a power storage through battery, if we use the wind generation along with the battery system so that the output from the wind generation can be constant according to the requirement. Whenever there is a high velocity of wind, the storage up to certain percentage will be there, and at the time of low velocity of wind and wind generation is less, at that time battery will help to give the constant output. This may happen, but it will take time. As on today, in India, at only Tata or the Pondicherry have the battery storage plant up to the 10 megawatt. But rightly said that this is the need of the time for the future grid system stability. If there is more and more renewable generation, it should be along with the battery storage.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for your perspective. Let me move to Mr. Shobhit. You know, we would like to hear you and your perspective on the O&M experience, you know, for the rooftop projects. Now, rooftop projects are have a unique characteristics. I mean, they are typically in city locations, so they are exposed to relatively, you know, dusty climatic conditions. So what kind of challenges and that you see for O&M, you know, in terms of honoring the you know, the performance ratio and the kind of the efficiency parameters that you have otherwise promised as a RESCO player to your customers? So on the O&M aspect, maybe you can just throw some light.
I think as far as O&M is concerned, it's, you know, after the installation, it's one of the more, you know, the entire plant performance depends on, you know, how you maintain your plants. Because, you know, once and right now, again, you know, the major challenges, especially in the CNI segment, is, you know, the dusting issue, which has to be, you know, catered in order to ensure that, you know, we get a plant performance. Other O&M activities that, you know, normally which becomes a bottleneck at the site is that, you know, the availability of the skilled manpower, and also the, you know, sizes of the project, which again, you know, makes a little more challenging for, you know, IPPs to deploy a dedicated manpower at the site. Other important aspect that, you know, I feel that, you know, there is a lack of understanding between a data logger and SCADA, which is which again, you know, helps in the plant performance. So I think, you know, which something that, you know, as an IPP or as an EPP, as an EPC, we focus on that, you know, we ensure that, you know, we have a dedicated SCADA system irrespective of the size of the rooftop projects or the ground mounted projects, so that, you know, we have fault level monitoring right from, you know, the data centers that we have at the offices, which where, you know, our people can guide the site technicians to ensure that, you know, we have almost negligible downtime. So I think the challenges in the industry, you know, in order to categorize it, is that, you know, availability of the skilled manpower, availability of you know, proper communication network at the site in order to get the fault level monitoring, as well as, you know, the availability of, you know, sometimes at the sites, the availability of water for cleaning, which we feel that, you know, especially in urban cities, at least we require three cycles in order to, you know, get the proper plant performances and the PRs.
Thank you, Shobhit. Another perspective, maybe you can just share with us on the model quality, because that is of paramount importance for everyone. And even though the solar industry is what, 8 to 10 years old in India, even then, you know, we talk about concerns related to the model quality. So how do you, what kind of safeguards that you put in place in terms of ensuring the model quality, and what's your experience so far?
I think as far as module quality is concerned, you know, nowadays, you know, since the market has become very cost conscious, I think that's the wrong way to approach it, because of, you know, there are too many, you know, tier 2, tier 3 players also which has entered into the market, which is actually, again, you know, creating a trouble. As far as, you know, for us, the module selection is concerned, we are very particular about, you know, the bill of material for any of the model that we choose, and I think you know, the BOM, which especially in the BOM, you know, people are just talking about the cells, but I think apart from the cells, I think, you know, it is very important to note about the kind of back sheets that are being used, you know, about the lengths of the cable that have been given by the module manufacturer, because that plays a very important role in terms of DC losses. Other major thing that, you know, it's about the size of the cells, because, you know, the technology has been evolving. So I think the size of the standard cells from 156 by 156 has, you know, gone up to 166 by 166. So, you know, the module efficiency, as well as, you know, the degradation factor of the modules have drastically, you know, improved. So, you know, I think most important thing about the model selection should be, you know, identifying the, you know, make of the cell. Secondly, the make of the back sheet. Third is, you know, the cable lengths. Of course, you know, the thickness of the glass has become standard now. So I think, you know, before, you know, the other important aspect that, you know, a EPC player or IPP that, you know, should take into consideration should be the, you know, tolerance of the modules that, you know, you normally, you know, should be asking for the flash test data from the module manufacturer before dispatch, so that, you know, you get to know about the tolerances of the modules and the other characteristics, electrical characteristics of the modules. As far as the, I mean, we have with the experience of, you know, around, you know, using various makes of modules, we have seen, you know, failures in the back sheet. We have also seen failures, you know, in terms, we have also seen the kind of you know, snail cracks, which are not, you know, which are not easy to, you know, see that physically during the installation process. So I think, you know, what any IPP or a developer or a consumer should ensure that, you know, specifically in, you know, for the large scale projects, is that, you know, get the thermal imaging done, you know, after 4 to 5 years to see that, you know, what are the issues that they face that could be the snail cracks or the failures of the backsheet, so that you know we can you know get the timely replacement as far as the warranty claims are concerned. Also, what we have seen in you know most of the you know EPC players not you know adhering to the warranty policies, which where you know they are neglecting the you know module to module earthing, which has you know again been you know major challenge in the industry, because of which there has been you know failures of modules and you know degradation levels, PID issues in the modules. So I think these are important aspects that you know anyone buying a module should you know first read the warranty policy in order to ensure that you know they tomorrow if there is a warranty claim, all the parameters which are required for a warranty claim have been factored in right during the installation phase, and you know there is not a conflict between the supplier and the EPC or the consumer at a later stage. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Shobhit. We also have a cell manufacturer on the dais.